Welcome to part 5 of this Unity tutorial series, where we're creating a survival shooter game using Unity's new implementation of the Entity Component System pattern, or Unity ECS for short. In this video, we'll be implementing player shooting by using a more pure approach to Unity ECS. Now, we'll be covering a lot of new concepts, so we won't be able to complete all of the logic in this one video. But don't worry, because what we don't complete in part 5, we'll definitely finish in parts 6 and 7. Well, without further ado, let's get right into the video. Before we dive into the code, we should give our character avatar a weapon. We are implementing player shooting after all. For now, I'll just use a cube as a placeholder. The art team can come in later and replace all of the models. Perfect. Looks just like the guns in Westworld. Okay, fine, it doesn't. But you aren't watching this for my artistic abilities. As basic as it is, it'll definitely work as a point of reference for where we should spawn the player's bullets. Let's add an empty game object to the player prefab now to serve this purpose. Our logic will use this game object to create bullets with the right position and rotation. So we'll need to convert it into an ECS entity. We'll accomplish this by adding a game object entity component that'll register this game object as an entity in the active world. Now, if we were taking a hybrid approach, this would be enough. Our system code would simply use the game object's transform component to retrieve the position and rotation. But we're going to write pure ECS code that uses the C# job system, so we'll need to use components that are compatible. To illustrate this, let's create a class file called Weapon Component and open it in the IDE. Unity's C# job system only supports structs and value types, so we can't use monobehavior-based components anymore. Pure ECS components are structs that derive from iComponent data. But how do we get this component onto our bullet spawn game object? Well, since pure ECS isn't fully fleshed out yet, the developers over at Unity have included a few helper classes to make the transition from hybrid ECS a little easier. One such helper is the Component Data Wrapper class, which itself derives from MonoBehavior. Behind the scenes, the Component Data Wrapper class uses its generic type parameter to add pure ECS components to game object-based entities. All we need to do is attach the weapon component to the bullet spawn game object. We can even run the scene and see that the weapon component has been added to the entity. Now, we can apply this same concept again using some pure ECS components that come pre-packaged with Unity ECS. Let's add the position and rotation components now. We'll also need to utilize another one of those helper classes called Copy Transform from Game Object Component. This should be pretty self-explanatory, but just in case it's not, this component will copy the position and rotation values of the game object's transform component to the respective pure ECS components. Again, we can see this in action by running the scene. The position and rotation components are updated when the player avatar moves around the scene. With our entity components in place, it's time to write our first system. I'll call it Player Shooting System and open it in the IDE. Now, the core logic for player shooting will be split up into two different systems. One system, let's call it the firing system, will be responsible solely for creating bullets. And the other system, the one we have open now, will be responsible for notifying the firing system when it's time to create bullets for the player. It'll do this by monitoring input and adding a special tag component to the player's weapon entity whenever the fire button is pressed. The firing system will be designed to react to this component and create bullets whenever an entity is tagged. Why don't we go ahead and create this component now? We can simply call it firing. Again, we're writing pure ECS code, so our components need to be structs that derive from iComponent data. Likewise, our systems need to derive from jobComponentSystem and override the onUpdate method. The onUpdate method receives and returns a jobHandle object. The jobHandle class is part of Unity's new C# job system. If you aren't familiar with it already, I highly recommend checking out my video on the subject. But basically, the C# job system provides a new way to write highly efficient, multi-threaded code, and it's used heavily with pure ECS. The onUpdate method expects us to schedule a job that holds our system's logic. Let's write that now. I'll call it player shooting job. And I'll have it derive from iJobParallel4, which is one of many job types that we can create. iJobParallel4 jobs are basically for loops that run in parallel. The execute method, which is called when you schedule a job, takes an index, which signifies where the program is in the loop at any given time. This system is responsible for tagging specific entities with the firing component. So let's add an entity array field that we can reference in our logic. We'll need to add components to these entities as well, but unfortunately, we don't have access to the entity manager here. So we'll need to add something called an entity command buffer. It isn't safe to add, delete, or modify entities while a job is still running. Command buffers allow you to queue up these types of actions so that Unity can perform them at the appropriate time. Concurrent buffers are specifically used for jobs that run in parallel, or concurrently. Let's use the entity command buffer to add a firing component to each entity in our entity array. Now, we only want to add the firing component when the player is actually firing, which in our case will be when they press the Fire 1 button. Let's add a Boolean field and use it as a guard clause in our logic. There. Now, we'll only add firing components to entities when the player is firing. But which entities do we want to add the firing component to? We need to add a data struct to this system to define our entity type, just like we've done in the past. It should include an int called length, which now must be a read-only field, an entity array, and a component data array that'll be used by Unity to only grab the entities that have the weapon component. And, just like before, we'll inject our struct into a private field. We're almost ready to schedule the player shooting job, but there's one more thing we need to do. We're going to create something called a barrier. Barriers live on the main thread and are used to create valid entity command buffers for our system jobs. Let's create one now, called player shooting barrier, and derive it from barrier system. Then inject it into the player shooting system. Now we're ready to schedule the player shooting job. Calling schedule on a job results in a job handle, so we can stick this in a return statement. iJobParallel4's schedule method takes a length, a batch size, and another job handle. And lastly, we can populate our jobs field variables. And that's all there is to it. Well, almost. I suspect we're going to run into a small problem. Let's run the scene and find out. Yep, the system runs fine the first time. But afterwards, it fails because we're trying to add the firing component to an entity that already has it. This will be a quick fix. We just need to add a subtractive component to our data struct for the firing component. This will ensure that this system only operates on entities that have a weapon component and don't already have a firing component. Beautiful. No more errors. And we can check the entity debugger and confirm that the weapon now has the firing component. If you'd like to download the project files for this video and support my content at the same time, please consider becoming a Tier 2 patron today. You can find a download link in the description and comments below. So, we just covered a lot of new concepts. Don't worry if you didn't catch it all the first time. In the next video, we'll be doing a little bit of a review by implementing a similar system that'll be responsible for the rate of fire. If you found this video helpful, please leave a like and a comment letting me know what you thought. And for more Unity tutorials just like this one, don't forget to subscribe with notifications on. I'll catch you in the next video. Thank you to all of my patrons, and a special shout out to Thomas, Chance McDonald, Glasswell Entertainment, Richard Stance, and Yakov.